So how would that even happen? There's not a lot of particular nerves that I've been able to find that are dedicated specifically to eudaimonic well-being. As far as we can tell, this is all about the sympathetic nervous system, which is mostly about fight or flight stress responses. And while there's some people that are very excited about various molecules of well-being, oxytocin or whatever, I frankly have not been able to, see anything that gives me any confidence that those molecules are playing a major role in this particular gene expression dynamic that I've just been talking about. So I feel like I'm stuck with the sympathetic nervous system, and I need to come up with a story about how this whole system would respond differently in a person who had a whole lot of eudaimonic well-being, a whole lot of dedication to others outside their own immediate self-gratification. And I have two young kids, and so I feel a constant sense of personal misery and great personal mission simultaneously. And this is, it turns out, not uncommon. Lots of folks have talked for years about the idea that humans seem to have this unusually strong caregiving system, and that it, as species become more social, they seem to evolve progressively more, sort of complex and, if you will, sort of deployable caregiving systems. And a lot of theorists have suggested that this is intimately tied up in the sort of the parasympathetic nervous system in general and activation of the vagal system in particular. I'm kind of, I'm not that much a vagus expert, and this certainly is not mediated by acetylcholine signaling. But it is reasonably plausible in the sense that, what do we learn in physiology 101 about one of the major things the parasympathetic nervous system does is it tends to inhibit the activity of the sympathetic nervous system. So at least one potential explanation, don't get me wrong, this is not proven science yet, this is just my momentary speculation. It fits with what some other people have been saying, but by no means demonstrated fact at this point. Nevertheless, one possibility is that this caregiving system is more activated in people with eudaimonic well-being, and as a result, they feel less, if you will, sort of neurobiological personal sense of threat because they're more focused on taking care of something besides themselves, whatever that may be. So it's possible that you're getting, sort of cross-inhibition of the sympathetic nervous system by greater activation of these kinds of parasympathetic dynamics in people that are, in some sense, living the biological caregiving system that seems to be present there in our bodies. Now, this is not the only possible way of retrimming that particular gene expression program I talked about earlier. And in fact, at this point, if you were to ask me what's the most reliable way to redirect that adverse gene expression profile, much to my consternation, I would have to concede that it appears to be meditation. So all of you folks who've been doing meditation studies as part of the integrative and complementary medicine exercises, congratulations to you. Your stuff works, at least at the level of molecular biology. There's an increasing number of studies, some of them sort of observational comparisons of people who are, sort of long-term practitioners of mindfulness or relaxation response, but some flat-out randomized controlled experiments where you take people and you randomize them to different interventions, some of which involve mindfulness. You can do this with yoga, Tai Chi, that kind of thing. And these fairly reliable lead to small but detectable favorable redirects within that two-dimensional gene expression space. So you get reductions in inflammatory gene expression and often notably better expression of these type 1 interferon response genes. You can also get that out of cognitive behavioral stress management. At least so far, the only place we've done that is in the context of people who themselves are confronting a huge amount of stress. So Mike Antoni's study is in women who've been diagnosed with early stage breast cancer. So they're quite concerned about their, they feel like, this very high likelihood that they're going to die soon. Thankfully, that's not the case. But nonetheless, you can't diagnose somebody with cancer and not have them feel a profound sense of threat and worry and anxiety. And so if he delivers cognitive behavioral stress management protocols in that scenario, you get a fairly favorable redirect in this adversity-related transcriptome fingerprint as well. So these things can be redirected in humans with exactly the kinds of, if you will, sort of intervention strategies that have been a central topic of research at your institute now for years. So that's sort of a little bit of an extended answer to one of these questions about which kinds of transcription control pathways mediate these effects. We know something about the transcription factors involved, the cells involved. We know something about the peripheral neurobiology, the sympathetic nervous system, the HPA axis. And we know increasingly about what types of central nervous system processes are involved, and even have a sense of what sorts of interventions might potentially be effective at redirecting those kinds of central nervous system dynamics in a more productive direction.